Ragosa, you ready?
Good evening, Berkeley High School families and students of the class of 2027. It's really exciting to welcome you to our ninth grade information night. My name is Juan Ragosa, and I am the principal here at Berkeley High. This is my sixth year at BHS and my third year as the principal, and I love BHS as it's an amazing place to work, teach, and learn. All of us care deeply about making sure that we care for and support our students from the first day they come into our campus until they cross the stage at graduation. Tonight, I look forward to having you hear from many of the staff at BHS that work hard every day to make the ninth grade experience a great one, as well as staff that will be here for you and your student during their entire time with us. After learning about the structure, programming, and resources that our Universal Ninth Grade program will offer to your students next year, you'll also learn about our many athletics and extracurricular opportunities and supports for families. Finally, we want to make sure you are clear about the next steps for your students' enrollment and course selection. With all that said, welcome, and I'm very excited to introduce the next speaker, Ms. Tanya Coleman, Vice Principal, who has many responsibilities, and one she's most proud of is serving as the administrator of the Universal Ninth Grade Program. Buenas noches, familias de Berkeley High School y estudiantes de la clase de 2027. Es realmente emocionante darle la bienvenida a nuestra noche de información de noveno grado. Mi nombre es Juan Ragosa y soy el director aquí en Berkeley High. Es mi sexto año en BHS y mi tercer año como director, y me encanta BHS porque es un lugar increíble para trabajar, enseñar y aprender. Todos nosotros nos preocupamos profundamente por asegurarnos de cuidar y apoyar a nuestros estudiantes desde el primer día que ingresan a nuestro campus hasta que crucen el escenario en la graduación. Esta noche espero que oigan de muchos de los miembros del personal de BHS que trabajan todos los días para hacer que la experiencia del noveno grado sea excelente, así como del personal que estará aquí para usted y su estudiante durante todo el tiempo que estén con nosotros. Después de conocer la estructura, la programación y los recursos que nuestro programa universal del noveno grado ofrecerá a su estudiante el próximo año, también aprenderá sobre nuestras numerosas oportunidades y apoyos deportivos y extracurriculares para las familias. Finalmente, queremos asegurarnos que tenga claro los próximos pasos para la inscripción y selección de cursos de su estudiante. Dicho todo esto, bienvenido y estoy muy emocionado para presentar la próxima oradora, la señora Tanya Coleman, subdirectora, quien tiene muchas responsabilidades y una de las que está más orgullosa es de servir como administradora del programa universal del noveno grado. Señora Coleman, sigue.
Thank you, Principal Ragosa. Good evening and welcome. Here are tonight's presenters, and you've already heard from Principal Ragosa. I am Tanya Coleman, Executive Vice Principal, working in collaboration with the Universal Ninth Grade. Logistics for this evening. You should have received two documents that will be helpful for tonight's presentation. These documents can also be found at our website. Questions. If you have questions this evening, please put the subject first and then ask your question in the chat. I would now like to present to you our 2022 welcome video created by our video production class.
Welcome to Berkeley High School. My name is Jasdeep Molly, also known as Ms. Molly to you guys, and
I believe it muted. I think the sound cut out.
I'll fight for that white girl. This one for them good girls, great masterpieces. Styling, violent, living it up in the
city. Here I am entering the front doors of Berkeley High School. We're at the D building, where you will come in to check in and find this amazing front office staff. It's also where you will find the principal's office, the vice principal's office, and your counselors. one of the most helpful resources on campus.
I was most concerned with how big Berkeley High was, and just kind of like overall how it'd be treated by upperclassmen. But once I got to Berkeley High, everything kind of worked itself out.
Here we are in the D building, right behind the area we checked in. In this building, you can find the principal's office, the administrator's office, and also your counselors. Remember, all of these people are here to help you with your journey at Berkeley High.
I got to Berkeley High, I was mainly concerned about playing football and doing sports stuff like that. When I got here, it was more like there's so many resources around here, so many places to do your work, so many study halls, CCCs, stuff like that. And it was just easy.
I'm here in the Berkeley High School cafeteria. This is one of my favorite places on campus, not just because it's got great food, but because of the people who work here and how warm and welcoming this place feels. You can come here to get lunch at the salad bar, the snack bar, come get some milk for your cereal. Whatever it is you need, it's open early in the morning until the afternoon. Come hang out and get some of this yummy food. As I walk out of the cafeteria, I find myself in the famous courtyard. Here we hang out as students, staff, and come together as the Berkeley High community. Directly across from the courtyard, to my left, is the Deckett Gym, and behind me is the C building. The A building is where the community theater is, and there's construction going on, but when there's not, it's definitely a cool place to see some drama.
One thing I was worried about was getting egged freshman year, because my cousin's like, oh yeah, freshman Friday, you're gonna get egged. And then when it was the freshman Friday, eggs weren't even thrown, so I was like, oh.
So here we are on the campus green. Behind me, you will find the famous M building. I say that it's famous because that's where you will find most of your world language departments and some amazing, fabulous teachers. You will also see next to the M building is the Donahue Gym. Obviously, it's where if you have a PE class, that might be where it's being held. And next to the Donahue is where our famous football field is. Go Jacket!
In the beginning, I was afraid of playing sports. My main thing, I was going to come here and play football. It wasn't as bad when it turned out. Like last year, I did really good in sports. I did really good in sports, and my grades really good, so turned out well.
Overall, Berkeley High is just like a safe place, and people understand you. You give them the chance to, it'll do great things for you.
I'm standing in the middle of G1 and H1. In the G building, you will find a lot of your science classes. In H building, I'm going to show you something really special on the first floor. Walk with me.
I was really concerned about this school being like really large and all of my classes are going to be really difficult. But once I came, in reality, all the teachers are very nice and they really want to help their students.
Once I got here and I had like classes with everybody, they were like way more open, and then I still got to connect with other people from different small schools and like experience high school and older people and having a whole bunch of freedom, and it was like cool.
I find myself on H1, and as I'm walking down the hallway, I know that I have the Student Support Center right behind me in H104 and also the Berkeley High Health Center. That's right. Berkeley High has its own health center, and here you can access counseling, you can access first aid and medical services, you can access information about your health education. The Berkeley High Health Center is open for in-person appointments. Call them and make your appointment now.
Worried about the size and how big the school would be. There would be like so many different people in my classes and stuff. And not being able to spend time with my friends actually didn't seem that big at all. And you do have time to like be with people and do the things you like, and you're able to like find your people and make new friends.
Well, Jackets, that's the end of this tour. We hope it's been useful for you to get a tour of our wonderful campus. We can't wait to see you in the fall. Bye. Welcome to Berkeley High School.
Video production is one of the many electives that our ninth graders can take. If you're watching this video and you're inspired, please select video production as one of your elective choices. I would now like to introduce to you Ms. Manassian. Ms. Manassian is one of the co-designers of the Universal Ninth Grade. She is the U9 teacher leader and teaches ethnic studies and social living in Hive 1, also known as the Growth Hive.
Thank you, Ms. Coleman. I'm gonna start with welcome everybody and welcome to the class of 2027, especially to our students who are joining tonight. The first thing we're gonna do is actually hoping that you are in a room with your young people. And if we were live and in person, we would ask you to do this. So we wanted to give you a chance to just take 20 seconds and turn to your young people around you and ask them, answer this question for them. What was your best memory from high school and why did it stick with you? I'm just gonna give you 15 seconds to answer that question to the people around you. What's your best memory from high school and why did it stick with you? Okay, can we get the next slide, please? Thank you. So I'm gonna go through just the overall structure and the goals for the students in the Universal Ninth Grade. We call it the U9. And it stands for Universal Ninth Grade. And in the middle in this circle are the goals for all of our students in the U9, that they have strong and consistent academic experience in four content areas you'll hear about tonight, a smooth transition between eighth and ninth grade, personalized experiences, early support, so it's high rigor and high help, common classroom practices, so they have a common experience coming into the ninth grade, and one thing, one of our goals for the students, but also for the adults in the U9 is that it was built collaboratively by this faculty, the ninth grade faculty. If you are a ninth grade teacher at Berkeley High, that is all you do. You are, your entire life and world is ninth grade. And improved outcomes for all students. So how do we do that? Those are the red bubbles you see around you. It's our professional development. It's our community building. We just took 800 students to a movie today. Actually, we just all went and saw Wakanda Forever. So a lot of the teachers on this seminar, on this webinar, deserve a lot of praise for a very long day they've had. Structured student support, knowledge and understanding of our students. Every kid, no kid falls through the cracks. Every kid is known well and known at least by four adults on campus. Consistent common practices and some performance-based assessments that are aligned. Next slide, please. This is our structure. It's a house structure. Some of you would know it as houses. We call them hives. We are aware that yellow jackets make nests and we are okay with that inconsistency, but we are called the hives and there are seven of them. There are about 120 students per hive and each hive has four core academic classes, English, history, math, and science. And all four teachers are wrapped around those 120 students and the two electives that the students have, they take outside of the hive. Next slide. So here are our sample, here's a sample hive. There are seven of these and one more click there that will get us our kids. Two more, yeah, there we go. This is our physics teacher, our English teacher, our freshman seminar teacher, and our math teacher. You're gonna hear a little bit about each of these subject areas, and there are our very happy, thrilled children in the middle. And this is actually how it feels as well. This is both the visual, but it feels like we're wrapped around them. Next slide. We have seven values. So seven, that's the growth hive is hive one, integrity hive is hive two, voice hive is hive three, justice is hive four, empathy is hive five, respect is hive six, and leadership is hive seven. That's a staff picture from, I believe it's our first year, but we actually have quite a few of those folks still around. We're very lucky with our turnover. So just what does it mean to be in a hive? This is sort of what it looks like. So seven hives for these seven values. And if you go to the next slide, it'll show kind of what looks like split up. So that hive split up physics, math, English, freshman seminar, and then your two electives. So there aren't really separate physical spaces for the hives. This is just these are the classes that you travel in. And then your electives are students from all over the school in all grade levels. And that's world language, PE, art, or a LEAP class, which we'll talk about in a little bit. Next slide, please. What do other hives look like? Well, they look exactly the way your hive looks. And this is sort of how we sort our 800 students. And every hive has their own four teachers who teach the same thing that our hive teaches. And all 28 of us, so that's four teachers times seven hives, plus the counselors, librarians, special education teachers, and our administrators work together. We make up the U9. Next slide, please. Questions the kids often ask, wait a minute, why am I in this hive? Well, that's because Berkeley schools are so diverse that when we sort you randomly, you actually become diverse in all the ways that matter to us. And so you get randomly sorted during the summer. And when you get to ninth grade orientation, you will find out who your teachers are and therefore you'll know what hive you're in. And so just again, just to sort of put too fine a point on it, this is my hive right now. This is the growth hive. And so what does it mean? It means you share your teachers with all the other people in your hive. So you don't travel as a cluster necessarily, where like if you're in physics period one, then you're in math period two and freshman seminar period three. It's not like that. It's those 120 kids scrambled among those four teachers for four periods during the day. And one of the most exciting features is that you can be in your math class and kind of turn to someone and be like, does anyone remember what the English homework was? And everybody should remember what the English homework was, because all of those people also have the same English teacher. Next slide, please. Okay, so the way our content works is, and you're gonna hear from folks tonight about English, math, physics, and freshman seminar. That's our ethnic studies and social living requirement. And again, you'll have a chance to select two electives in the spring of your eighth grade. So we'll come to you. And when you select classes, we have to pick two of them because Ms. P, I think you're unmuted suddenly. You only have to pick two of them because the other classes are chosen for you. So you'll pick from your world language, from your PE, from art, et cetera. Next slide. I'm gonna hand it over to our awesome English teachers, Ms. Panabianco and Ms. Wachtel. They're lead teachers for English, and they are gonna talk to us about the English content.
Thank you, Hasmik. Hi everyone, I'm Julie Panabianco. I teach English with U9, obviously, and I am with the Respect Hive, Hive 6. So we're gonna talk about English. Ms. Wachtel, my co-lead for English, is gonna share this with me. And we really have created a curriculum over these past 5 years that we hope helps kids develop their voice, helps kids see themselves in the books that we read, the conversations we have. You can keep clicking. Thank you. Kids will be reading and writing widely and often and in a variety of ways. We analyze texts critically. Kids make their own structured arguments using academic language. And I think there's one more. And really important to us, and based off of the structure of U9, we want kids to learn collaboratively with their peers, build a community with one another, and we do this in a number of ways throughout the year.
Yeah, and I'm Maya Wachtel. I'm another English teacher in the U9. And so building off of what Ms. Panabianco said, we work towards all of those goals through an exploration of these four main categories of essential questions and asking our students to explore these ideas. You know, what is the power of language? How do we create and use and understand authentic voice and the meaning that comes from it? We ask them to explore major themes, to think about how reading and writing and literature and storytelling can help us gain perspective on complex issues that show up in our various texts. we ask them to think about how writers construct compelling arguments and how they base those arguments on strong and effectively analyzed evidence so that they can be responsible consumers of information this year and for all of their years to come. And then we finally ask them to think about all that they have learned from other writers and other speakers and explore applying those same strategies to their own writing. And so assessing all of these kind of newly gained skills through reading and writing, through speaking and listening, and a variety of fiction and nonfiction texts to kind of demonstrate all of the ways that they can communicate and make meaning. And so a typical day in English class, while we cover a whole bunch of different topics throughout the year and a whole bunch of different texts, the day-to-day kind of program looks relatively similar. So we always begin with independent reading and or journaling to warm up, get our brains ready to get into class. That's usually followed by a warm up, and then we'll get into our core curriculum, which can be a variety of activities, reading and annotating, direct instruction and modeling, discussions, both formal and informal, and individual work as they kind of make sense of things on their own.
And IR, or independent reading, is a huge part of our program. Students choose a book that they want to read, and they read it during class about 4 to 5 times a week at the start of class, as you just heard from Ms. Wachtel. They also are responsible for reading about 20 minutes a night outside of class. And this is based on a lot of research that shows that when students are reading, when people are reading, which Dr. Krashen calls free voluntary reading, really great things happen academically, such as increased reading comprehension, ability to write more effectively, have better vocabulary, spelling, grammar, and also as many of us may be readers ourselves, we know that there's a lot of other emotional and societal and all sorts of personal benefits from reading, but we definitely try to engage kids with the academic benefits for them as well. And we get great feedback from our independent reading program. Most of the kids are successful with it. A lot of them report that it's a really calm, lovely way to start class and sort of transition mentally into English and into the classroom.
They also talk about how nice it is to be surrounded by people who are always also focused on reading. It's magical to kind of look around and see 30 kids deep into a book that they are excited to read.
Kids also really like to be able to choose what they're reading because sometimes they don't love the books that their English teachers are forcing them to read. And so they get to choose topics they're passionate about and writers and authors that they can read series of. So they enjoy that choice as well.
Yeah, and finally, they often just really love to talk to their teachers and classmates about their books and getting recommendations. And so using their resources around each other, around themselves to continue to build their interest and love of reading.
And overall, this creates just a really great culture and community of reading in our class, which then transfers over to writing as well.
So that's a little bit about English, and I will now pass it on to our physics teacher, Ms. Augustine, who will share about United Physics.
Thanks. Hi, my name is Vicky Augustine. Adrian Altawil and I co-lead the physics group. We have, as you know now, 7 physics teachers. All students take physics, and our physics course is algebra-based. It's a really great course. It will offer your students a physical science credit. We are aligned with the next generation science standards, and this summer we are going to align even more with them. We're going to improve our course around that. We have over 60 labs a year. It's an inquiry-driven program. And in addition to all of our hands-on labs, we also have a project each quarter. It supports the math sequence, we have a whole bunch of equipment. We have smart cards, we have MacBooks, we have a lot of duct tape, which is my favorite, all kinds of other things as well. And I think we're on the next slide. Great. So our first two, the first semester, the first two quarters is focused on mechanics, motion and forces. We also study energy. And we have a build project each quarter. Our first quarter build project is called Crash It. It's a vegan egg drop. And students build something to protect their block. And they get to test it three times. So iteration is key there. Also, we're studying momentum and impulse primarily. Our second quarter project, which we are about to start tomorrow, and it'll be part of our midterm exam, is build a mini trebuchet. And students will be looking at efficiency, kinetic energy, potential energy, and projectiles. Our third quarter project is a debate about how electricity is generated in California. And that goes along with our third quarter studies, electricity and magnetism. As part of the debate, students will build a model or a map, do a map or a scientific drawing. And finally, fourth quarter is waves, sound, and light. And students build their own instrument, which is harder than it sounds. If you've ever played an instrument or built one, you know. We also have a great tutoring program, so students can get help from our physics teachers Monday through Thursday after school. One of the reasons why we can do that is because we're highly aligned. We do the same labs and the same quizzes every week. We also have many weekly, monthly, and quarterly schedules and procedures, which really help students start to enter into high school and also be successful, not only in physics, but in their upcoming science courses for subsequent years. Is there one more slide? Oh, here are some of our students building a mini trebuchet from other years. Let's go to the next one. We can see some duct tape in there. We can see one of the little skeletons on the side there. A trebuchet is different from a catapult. It works by a weight falling instead of tension on the arm, in case you didn't know. I think there's one more slide, and that's it. I'm really looking forward to meeting your students next year. I really, really enjoy being a part of U9 and physics. And now I'm turning it over to Nakia and Leah. Thanks.
Hi, thank you, Vicky. I'm Leah Alcala, and along with Nakia Baird, my colleague, we are the co-leads of the Math 1 team. So I'm going to introduce you to a problem that we present to our students on, I think, day 3. So I want you guys to play along and think about this answer as we go through math. So the Gloop family wants their son, Augustus, to do his homework every day. Augustus loves to eat candy. So his parents have decided to motivate him to do his homework by giving him candies for each day that his homework is complete. Mr. Gloop says that on the first day Augustus turns in his homework, he will give him 10 candies. On the second day, he promises to give him 20 candies. And on the third day, he will give him, 20 candies. And on the third day, he'll give him 30 candies, and so on. How many candies will Augustus get on day 30 in this plan? Let's see the next slide, and I'm going to pass it to Mr. Baird for a moment.
Hello, I'm Mr. Baird. I'm co-lead with Leah in math. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about the Math 1 course. So it's an integrated course that aligns with Common Core standards. And so it has topics from algebra, geometry, and statistics, and it's task-based. So students will tackle tasks. It's very student-centered, and so there's a lot of work that students do, and then we bring it back to the class. It's a lot of group individual work and then direct instruction to tie things together. And it's spiral learning, so we don't just learn a topic and leave it behind. It spirals back through and connects to the other topics in the course. Next. So some of the key ideas and topics are sequences and linear and exponential functions. We talk about features of functions and a lot of notation to describe that students haven't seen before. Equations, inequality, and matrices as mathematical structures that could be used to communicate information. And we also look at systems, both equations and inequalities, and then transformations and symmetry. So everything from what students have seen before on paper, and you can fold things to like, oh, maybe this is how some of our little devices work. And we talk about congruency, and we get into constructions and proof. And then we connect algebra and geometry, including vectors. And we have some statistics topics. So we talk quite a bit about statistics at the end of the year. Next. So some of the topics always seem familiar, and that's just the way mathematics is. It spirals back through, and each time we go deeper, and we learn more notation and way things that are connected that we didn't ever think or believe or were possible before. So it's really exciting as students say, oh, I've seen this before, and then it just, it opens up into something that they couldn't even imagine. And there's other topics other than these that, that are in the course as well. Next slide. So this is our math progression. So it's pretty simple, math 1, 2, 3. And so our seniors have options to take AP or IB courses. It depends on what program they go into. More on that later. We'll just focus on ninth grade. We also have a website that has a lot of information about the curriculum, and you can access that. And it talks more about the other courses and how everything ties together. All right.
Okay, we're back to our problem, and I saw you guys in the chat answering the question, which I really appreciate you guys doing a little math with us tonight. So let's look at the next slide to see what we would do. And I guess it's going to come. Hold on. Sorry, I'm getting a phone call. I think you have to click through this one here. Give me a couple clicks. Oh, just one. So if you, there's a whole bunch of stuff, and then look at the bottom there. So f of 30 equals 300. 300 is the answer we were looking for. How many candies will Augustus get on day 30? And what we noticed is this pattern of 10, 20, 30. And as you look at the work here, you should see the notation is pretty significant and new and fancy. And that's what we're working on layering onto this problem that is essentially a proportion. So they learn proportions in seventh grade. We layer on a little bit notation, grow it from here. You'll see the recursive formula where I tell you what the first term is and how two adjacent terms are connected. And then we talk about the explicit formula, how to go from position, what day it is, to how many candies there are. And you see that 10 times N, where N is the day number you're on. So that's what kids are going to be doing in the first couple of days. And it grows from there. And I'm going to pass it over to Hasmig, I believe, to talk about ethnic studies freshman seminar, social living.
Yes, thank you. So we have a class we call freshman seminar. That's the history course. It is the requirement, a graduation requirement for Berkeley High. And freshman seminar is broken down into two semesters. Semester one is ethnic studies, and semester two is social living. So ethnic studies, as you probably know by now, is now a California graduation requirement, a high school graduation requirement, but it has been one in Berkeley High since the 1990s. And we talk about examination of identity. We have three main units in ethnic studies. That's culture, immigration, and race. We look at the experiences and perspectives of the populations that came to the United States and live in the United States. And it's a lot of it is the investigation of history, both the past and the current political and global dynamics. We do a lot of personal connections through the community building, but also having them connect to their own personal identity, cultures, and histories. Next slide, please. Semester two is called social living, and that is where we do the last of the requirements for sexuality and gender identity, healthy decision-making, substance abuse, use and awareness, nutrition, basically how to make healthy choices and good decisions about your body, including mental health, stress, and stress reduction. We also continue or begin our consent education. The high school has consent education at almost every grade level, but we start in ninth grade, both at the beginning of the, when students first come into Berkeley High. This course has a unit called Unit Zero. And Unit Zero is basically sort of like a preparation for life in high school. We do consent education then, we do it again in the spring. And then there's a consent education series that we do sophomore, junior, and senior year. So that gets woven throughout. Our freshman seminar content, this is again some sample skills and assessments, critical thinking. We're right now in an immigration unit, and I was just thinking about how one of our assessments is having them look at current immigration policy and comparing it to the past immigration policy that we're learning about from the Reagan years, Reagan, Bush, all the way up through Clinton, Obama, and Trump era and Biden era. So they sort of do they span all of the immigration policies of the years. Doing a lot of listening, speaking, reading, and writing, source evaluation. We have a great relationship with our librarians who help us. And we do like a sample second semester assessment is a evidence-based research project on current social issues. Next slide. And now I'm gonna pass it on to Alex Day, one of our co-LEAP coordinators. And he's gonna talk a little bit about LEAP. A few of you have asked this question in the Q&A. So this is where we are answering LEAP questions live. Take it away, Alex.
Cool, good evening, everybody. So LEAP, it stands, as you see, for Learn, Engage, Accelerate, Persist. And I also teach Ethnic Studies and Social Living, but LEAP is one of my favorite classes I've ever taught in my 7 years, and here's why. So each class is roughly 8 to 10 students who are, it's an opt-in class. And so we go to middle school counselors in the winter as your students are choosing their classes in their middle schools and let the counselors know about it ahead of time. Counselors think who might be a good fit for this. We also are letting you know right now so that you and your students can be thinking, might this be a good fit for me in the 9th grade? So let me just say, skip right to the bottom of this slide to say that LEAP is an elective G credit class, meaning that it's part of the A through G requirements. Generally, elective G area electives are taken in junior or senior year. They can be literally anything that is a college prep class. LEAP is our college prep class, and so we've essentially moved something that usually happens in 11th and 12th grade and brought it into the 9th grade. And it's a really important class that we're making room for in the 9th grade while still keeping people on track for being college eligible. So I'll say a little bit more about that after I break down what LEAP is and why we think it's so important. So if you direct your attention to the sample week in a LEAP class, you'll see that it's a mix between in the spring semester, mostly academic skill self-assessment and skill building. So like how to write an email to a teacher, how to manage your time, what are good 2-minute or 5-minute or 10-minute break activities? How do we schedule breaks when we're studying? Things like how do we plan for our finals? How do we know what our finals are? How do we set up our study plans for our finals? Then in spring semester, the LEAP curriculum switches to college prep and career exploration. So we've already gone on one college field trip that's only for LEAP classes, and we'll go on another one, two more in the spring semester. And in the spring semester, we're doing a college research project. We're taking what do you want your lifestyle to be like when you're 25? How much is that going to cost you? And backwards plan from your budget what careers you can be looking at to meet your goals for yourself as a 9th grader. Okay, so that's the LEAP curriculum. Mr. Albinson, would you rewind for one more second? I got a little more to say about that sample week. Thank you. So you'll notice that some of this sample week is type of curriculum like I was just talking about. All right. Others of it, though, in each day is kind of split in roughly half. So you have 20, 25, 30 minutes of the period LEAP curriculum. Then it's direct support on assignments for other classes. All right. And now, Mr. Albinson, if you wouldn't mind switching to the next slide. And give us one more click so we see the kids in the middle too. Brilliant. Thank you so much. So we'll only be on the slide for a second just to remind you that there are 4 teachers all teaching the same 120 kids. All LEAP classes are pulled from a Hive and taught by a Hive teacher. So Mr. Albinson, if you would move to the next slide. Brilliant. Thank you so much. Okay. So here is that same sample hive with their LEAP classes. Okay, so every single LEAP student's LEAP teacher is also either their ethnic studies, their math, their physics, or their English teacher. So they're seeing them twice a day. And also, those LEAP teachers are in that teacher team of the hive. So we all talk to each other. We have hive meetings where we're collaborating and coordinating interventions with students, sitting in a room with the counselors and talking about our students that we want to support and how we're going to do that. And then we take all those conversations into the LEAP class. So when there's these 8 to 10 young people in the room, we can actually sit down with them and literally talk through, hey, I just talked to Ms. Wachtel, and she said, you still have that English paragraph from last week. You did a really good start in her class, but she wants you to finish up. Or I just talked to Ms. Gilden, and here's the math quiz that you started in her class in third period. It's now fifth period of the same day. Here, take 20 more minutes on it. And so beyond that, we're also, because we see them twice in the day, we have an extra level of relationship that we develop with it. Now, all research and education shows that relationship is the foundation for any good educational outcome, the relationship between educator and student. And so with LEAP students, what I've found personally and what I've heard a lot from students and LEAP teachers is that because you have that deeper relationship with those students, when you're sitting down to have that conversation about the English paragraph or what you're going to do for the finals or what are the reasons that you want to go to college, you can then like have a more you can really leverage your knowledge of that student and what you're hearing from other people to really have a stronger intervention in that moment. And then I believe, yes, indeed. So the fourth teacher in the hive is the hive lead. So right now we got actually all the U9 teachers except for myself who've spoken up to now are the lead teachers. They coordinate the professional development. So like they were just working really hard to get us to the Black Panther movie we saw today. Thank you very much, by the way. That was wonderful. Community building and then communications between the hive, the administration, and the families. So that's another strong benefit of this hive model is that we can kind of split up the labor of contacting families. And even if I'm the one talking to you about your student, you know that, okay, I've talked to these three other teachers and probably a couple of counselors too, and we're coming up with some ideas and working together in that way. And then I think there we go. Thank you so much, Mr. Allenson. So another unique feature of the U9 is the community. Well, a lot of community building at Berkeley High. Another good, great feature of the U9 is community building. And we have that time and that space to do that, both through the hive structure and also through LEAP. So there are some LEAP-specific community building activities and also LEAP-specific field trips that are a strong selling point, we believe. But then we also have it for the whole U9 community, both by Hive and then across the U9 with things like this movie field trip. We'll go to the A's game, hopefully in May, and then museums from time to time. We have in-class community building, and then also we have the lovely Miss Stacy Scholes, who will push in to our classes and help us run some tier one restorative justice circles, which essentially means structured community building circles. All right, and with that, I think that's all I have to say. Have a great evening. I'm sorry, I'm not sure who the special education person is, but I'm sure you're going to do a great job.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Monica Salvador. I'm a teacher leader in the special education department, and I'm also an IEP case manager. The next slide, this slide is actually a snapshot of what a typical ninth grade schedule could be. A student with an IEP would have a case manager, receive IEP accommodations, and would have options for general education electives, such as PE, world language, or art, as well as a CLC, or Collaborative Learning Center class, which is taught by a special education teacher. And in a CLC class, they would receive executive functioning support, such as organizational and time management, prioritizing coursework, increase awareness about their strengths and challenges, build self-advocacy skills, access accommodations such as extra time on tests and quizzes in an alternate setting, receive support on general education coursework and fundamentals of the core disciplines, English, math, and primary means of basically where they would receive their IEP services. Case managers would meet with their students in the CLC classroom, as well as provide transition services such as college and career awareness, which is all part of a high school IEP.
Thank you, Ms. Salvador.
You're welcome.
What electives do freshmen take? All right, so here's a list of our visual and performing arts electives that are available to ninth graders. Let's give you a moment to look at this. Here are some more electives available to freshmen. I should mention that robotics, stagecraft, and digital audio recording and engineering are offered during seventh period. Up next, we have the well-renowned veteran teacher leader, Ms. Lopez. And she's going to speak with us about the World Language Department.
Thank you, Ms. Coleman. Good evening, everybody. So at Berkeley High School, we offer a range of world languages, which always depend upon how many students sign up. Students with little or no previous language experience will be placed in level one. Students who have completed 2 years of the same language in middle school will be placed in level two automatically. This includes students from within BUSD, as well as from private and independent schools. If a student would like to place into level three or above, they will need to take a placement exam. The placement exam will take place in the spring. And sometime in early March, we will let the community know about how to sign up for the tests, and we will give exact dates for when the test will take place over Zoom. As far as students that are native Spanish speakers and students that come from the dual immersion program, they will be placed in the Spanish for Native Speakers program. Some of the students, depending on their proficiency level, will go into level one, and other students, especially the students that come from Longfellow, will be placed into level two. But they're also welcome to test into a higher level as well. And like I said, the test will take place over Zoom in April. Thank you very much. Thank you, Ms. Coleman.
Okay, so PE. There are three ways to get PE credit. One is to take one of these PE classes at BHS. Two, by being on a sports team, each season is equivalent to one semester. And three, some families choose to opt for a PE waiver, which amounts to the equivalent of taking a full-time course. There are limitations in how to account for these courses. One, students have to be self-motivated and participate in a serious, rigorous, and documentable sport activity outside of school 5 hours each week. Every year, some students choose this option, but they don't meet the deadline or requirement and find themselves without enough PE credits to graduate. We advise students to join a sport or to take 2 years of PE at BHS. I would now like to introduce Ms. Vecht, our athletic director.
Thank you, Ms. Coleman. Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us tonight. I'm Ms. Vecht, co-athletic director, along with my colleague, Ross Parker, whom you'll meet over the years. On the screen now, you see a list of all of the different sports that are offered at Berkeley High School through our Berkeley High Athletics program. If you remember nothing else from what I say tonight, Please note that you can find any information about Berkeley High Athletics at berkeleyhighathletics.org, berkeleyhighathletics.org. So this are all the sports that we offer year-round: cheer and crew, both of which are offered for all genders. And cheer tryouts are generally in the spring. They are the one thing that you try out for well in advance of the school year. However, we do have a freshman cheer squad now. So if your student comes, if your incoming ninth grader would like to try out for cheer, that is possible. But I would like to point out that our sports schedule is set by NCS. It's an outside governing body. And so often our sports tryouts for the fall sports happen about a week before school starts for the fall. So if your kid is really serious about one of those sports listed in the fall, for boys, that's cross country, football, water polo. For girls, that's cross country, field hockey, golf, tennis, volleyball, water polo, and girls are also welcome to try out for football, actually. Then those, that's something that you want to be aware of, because you may need to be in town at least 1 week before school starts in order to try out. Where would you find the date to try out? Good question. BerkeleyHighAthletics.org. Next slide, Ms. Coleman. Okay, Ms. Coleman was just talking about needing 2 years of PE credit in order to graduate. If your student participates in one of those sports through our department, the PE credit is automatic. She talked about a PE waiver. If you're on Berkeley High Athletics team, that is separate from a PE waiver. You do not need to fill out any additional paperwork or get a PE waiver. You just need to allow some lag time for the athletics credit to appear on your child's transcript. But all rostered athletes get 5 semester units per team of PE credit. So if your child plays one sport all 4 years of high school, they are done with their PE credits, and you never have to worry about getting PE credit outside of school or taking a PE class in school. Not every school offers that, but we do offer PE credit for participation in our sports teams. You have to participate from the beginning to the end of the season. And that oftentimes brings up the question of whether our sports are cut or not. Some sports are, some sports aren't. The goal is not to cut, but every sport is no cut until it is. So it really just depends on signups and what the capacity of a particular sport is. For many years, badminton was no cut, and then 1 year, all of a sudden, everyone was interested in badminton, and badminton became a cut sport all of a sudden. So we really can't tell you in advance whether something is or isn't. So it's just something to keep in mind. Next slide, Ms. Coleman. And I'll remind you, if you have any questions about athletics at Berkeley High School, then you want to visit berkeleyhighathletics.org. You can also follow us on Twitter or Instagram or both, and the information for that is there. On our website, berkeleyhighathletics.org, you can find information about registering your athlete. You can find the game schedule. You can buy tickets. We are able to stream some games, games that take place at our stadium and our Donahue gym. You can find coach names and contact emails. You can find a fan store if you want to buy some Berkeley High gear. All of that can be found on our website, berkeleyhighathletics.org. And one final note, we recommend you have, if you are interested in signing your child up for a sport, you need to get a physical examination by a doctor and get a form filled out. You can find all of that on our website. We generally, the physicals are good for 1 year. So our strong recommendation is that you come in by getting your physical done in the summer before you enter the school year. It's good for the whole year. And then each summer you go ahead and just renew your physical, so that during the course of the school year, you never have to worry about getting a doctor's appointment, getting the form filled out, uploading it, being ineligible because you don't have that. By law, we are not able to allow anyone to participate or try out without that clearance from a doctor. So you want to make sure that you get that taken care of. And if you don't have a regular doctor, you can find some referrals from us on our website. Again, takeaway, berkeleyhighathletics.org. And now I will hand it off to Mr. V, who will talk about student activities and clubs, including some sports clubs that are not part of our BHS athletics, but are part of student activities. Go ahead, Mr. V.
berkeleyhighathletics.org.
Yay, got it. You got it.
thanks everybody for joining us. And I'm here to congratulate you on reaching slide number 50 of our presentation and also talk about some ways that your student can get involved. My name is John Villavicencio, also known as Mr. V, Director of Student Activities here at Berkeley High School. And with student clubs, there are over 90 of them on campus right now, and they all operate at different levels of activity. You can always find that list. We keep it up to date on the main website. I put the link here, and I believe this presentation will be shared out, but if not, you can always contact me or just search the BHS website. Clubs have an open door policy, which means that at any part of the school year, they should allow new members or at least interested students to join them. And they mostly happen at lunch or maybe right after school. As previously mentioned, there are some sports clubs. That's mainly Ultimate Frisbee, the mountain biking team. There's a few kind of martial arts groups. There's been an orienteering club for a while. And there are a few other groups where you could, if your student signed up and participated early enough, get PE waiver credit. Just a note, if you don't like a club, or you don't see any clubs that you enjoy, you can always create your own by certain due dates. So that's something that students take great pride in doing. Next slide, please. So I do oversee BHS leadership, which operates for each grade level, as well as a few teams that represent the school as a complete community. There are also opportunities for your student later on to get involved in leadership through maybe the small learning community that they join, or just in any other capacity as being a leader of the classroom or of their own club. Maybe they want to start their own club someday. So BHS leadership is very inclusive in that way. Ninth grade students that are interested in participating in the program that I oversee, those applications would be available in early fall. There's nothing to do over the summer for that. Then one major plug that I want to put out there is that for the last 2 years, we've been doing video bulletins and we've been sharing them 3 times a week. So if you're interested in getting an inside view, kind of what the school is about, what are some things that are happening on campus? One thing that's really beautiful this school year is that we've had a really strong relationships with athletics. So we have commissioners of health and athletics, Sabine and Emmett, who have been putting together video recaps with athletes of the week, promoting games, getting people really excited about being a part of leadership and kind of building a stronger sense of place and connection to Berkeley High School. So it's been really great to have that, and for the students, they get to see that in the video bulletin. Those get shared during second period, where we have a time during the bell schedule that's set aside for playing those. But they're also available for you to watch on Instagram at Juice the Jackets, or also on the leadership webpage, which you could access a Google file for that. So I strongly encourage you to check those out at Juice the Jackets. And we just did a tour of the A building a few months ago. So if you were interested to see what the community theater and what the new A building is going to look like with the music classrooms and the sound recording and the video recording and film production that's going in there, soundproof rooms, it's really amazing stuff. I did a video tour and I'm hoping to do an update soon, but you could find that at Juice the Jackets or on the BHS leadership. Thank you so much. And I'm going to pass it over to Ms. Coleman.
Thank you, Mr. V. I would like to tell you about our Parent Resource Center. We have two amazing community leaders, Ms. Irma Parker and Ms. Letty, who run the Parent Resource Center. They're here full time. They're available for drop-in. They support families with resources if the need arises. They work closely with academic counselors, administrators, teachers to support students succeed. And so the Parent Resource Center is an amazing place, and they help families get into Infinite Campus if they get stuck and can't see their child's profile. Again, Ms. Parker and Ms. Letty are the two folks that run the Parent Resource Center. I would now like to introduce Ms. Vitoweta, our 504 coordinator. Oh, wait, sorry about that. A little early. Okay, what supports exist for all students? We have a range of supports. For all ninth grade students, we have the College and Career Center that's open every afternoon. The library is open for an hour from 3:30 to 4:30 after school. And then we have our Bridge and Rise program, which some of our eighth graders may be interested in. We also have our on-campus intervention. We have a full service health center that provides first aid and medical services, health education, and mental health counselors. And to access the health center, there's a health center consent form that you received in your registration packet that you'll need to turn in. And now I would like to introduce Ms. Vitoweta, our 504 coordinator.
All right. Good evening, everyone. So I'm Melissa Vitoweta. I'm the 504 program supervisor. I also oversee a few of our other support systems on campus. And I wanted to talk a little bit tonight about 504 plans. A lot of questions come up about 504 plans and their scope and purpose. And so as you've heard so far, the U9 is a really supportive environment for all students. There are a lot of built-in supports and strategies to support students in their academic success. And then there are also a lot of campus-wide supports that all students can access. So a 504 plan, this is for students who may have a mental or physical impairment that is preventing them from accessing all of the amazing programming in the U9 and at Berkeley High School. So Section 504 of the Americans with Disabilities Act is intended to protect individuals from discrimination on the basis of mental and physical impairments. So for us in schools, this means we protect access to educational programming. So we really take a look at these three things that you see here, whether the student has a physical or mental impairment, whether that impairment impacts a major life activity compared to their peers, and also whether the degree of impairment is substantial to a degree that requires accommodations. And I'll talk a little bit more about what that looks like on the next slide. And a student must be enrolled and attending at Berkeley High School to be evaluated for a 504 plan. Next slide, please. So what is a 504 plan? So if a student meets the criteria, a plan is developed to protect them from discrimination on the basis of an impairment. So a physical or mental impairment can be things like if a student is diabetic, maybe if a student has cerebral palsy or something that impacts mobility and getting around on campus. And so a 504 plan would include accommodations that remove barriers to educational access. So for a student who might be a diabetic student, do they need access to snacks or water in class at all times, even though that may not be part of the regular classroom practice? A 504 plan would be in place for that student to be able to access those things. Or if cell phones are not supposed to be in class, but this student who has diabetes may need their cell phone to monitor their glucose, that would be another example of an accommodation. So it's super specific to students who really need support so that they can benefit from all of the amazing programming and things that we have available at Berkeley High. So some considerations: can the student's needs be met with existing supports? We also have a student support process where if there are concerns about a student, we're able to meet meet, talk with their counselor, talk with teachers, and figure out if there are some really targeted supports that would benefit the student. And this is outside of the scope of a 504 plan. This would be available to students who may need additional support. And then, do we have data that suggests that a student might need a 504 plan? And finally, are those accommodations required for the student to access our programming? So you can find me on the Berkeley High staff website if you have other questions about 504 plans, but the U9 is really, really supportive, and we've found that they're able to meet the needs of most students in the general programming. I'll pass it back to Ms. Coleman.
Thank you. Okay, so how will students be assigned to the Hives? So students will be assigned randomly so that we get a balance that we seek in terms of academic diversity, as well as our common district indicators, such as parent education level, social economic status, et cetera. Okay, so what happens in the 10th through 12th grade? Students will indicate their preference in order for their learning communities, which is their SLC, their small learning communities. And here are our five small schools, or our four small schools, and then our larger school is academic choice. And students will be placed into a learning community by lottery according to the order that they ranked these programs and the availability of space in them. All students will continue to have access to higher level classes, such as our AP classes and our IB diploma track courses. All right, here are the logistics for enrollment. So everyone should have received their enrollment packet from admissions. You have until December 15th to turn in your enrollment packet. After December 15th, registration will not open up again until March 2023. So please fill out your enrollment packet and submit it to admissions. BUSD course selection. So what's going to happen is during these dates, an administrator, academic counselor are going to come to the middle schools, and they're going to support the eighth graders and picking their elective courses. So the dates are right here. If you are new to BUSD, your course selection night will be, or your date is indicated here. There's two Mondays, February 27th and March 6th. And your selection will happen online, and you'll work directly with an academic counselor so that you can pick your course electives. I now introduce to you Ms. Heidi Weber, a veteran administrator in Berkeley Unified.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for coming and joining all of us this evening. What an amazing presentation. I'm so excited for you all to join the U9. I was working with Ms. Manazian on the design team. It's an amazing program. And if you're looking for something a little bit different, Berkeley Unified has another program called Independent Study. It's a program of Berkeley High. It's a very small program for 9th through 12th graders. We have up to 170 students, with small group teaching and learning. Students take home 10 hours of independent studying for each class. It's an in-person program with a very, very few number of students doing a virtual option if they're at risk for COVID-19. The application and orientations are the first steps. Our orientations for independent study for next year start in April. And if you would like more information, please visit us at our website, berkeleyindependentstudy.wordpress.com, and email us at berkeleyindependentstudybis@berkeley.net. It's really important for us to note, though, that the same requirements that are at Berkeley High for the U9 are at Independent Study. Thank you, everyone. I'll hand it right back to you, Ms. Coleman.
Thank you, Ms. Weber. All right, so the BHS Development Group, they raise and administer funds to support the academic experience of BHS students. If you would like to get involved, here's the website. You're able to join the board. They meet the first Monday of each month. And again, here is the website if you would like to donate. Are you interested in volunteering at BHS? Please reach out to Berkeley Public Schools. We have parent volunteers support us in the front office every day of the week. This webinar has been recorded and will be available on our website. Thank you all for joining us this evening and good night. Are there any questions left that need to be answered?
We're still live, just for folks to know.
I'm going through the Q&A to see if there are any SPED-related questions I should be answering.
Tanya, there are a few questions on there about the enrollment packets and like what if people didn't get them and that the links are old, et cetera, but I'm not sure. And again, there are still 134 people in the room, so.
Okay, I'll put the enrollment packet in the chat.
I think maybe if people still have questions, how should they get those questions answered?
I'm looking for the enrollment packet. Can you put my email in the chat?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, here's the enrollment packet.
So, let's see. There's a few live questions left. I mean, a few questions. The recording of the webinar is going to be posted on the Berkeley High School website.
Yes.
If you're an inter-district transfer, new to BUSD, let's see. Can a ninth grader take more than one language class if they are a native speaker in one language and want to learn another language as well? Not more than one language class at a time. If you're a native speaker in one language and you want to take a different language, that's fine, but you can't take two languages at the same time. PE waiver, that means you just have if you have a PE waiver, that means you have a room for another elective. It's not like a free period. You have a room for another elective in your class.
Hosmig, I see someone asking about who LEAP is intended for. Do you mind if I answer that real quick?
No, go for it.
All right, so LEAP is a great class because it can meet a lot of different needs of a lot of different types of students. Essentially, it's a student who needs support beyond their classes that isn't in another program for support. So doesn't have an IEP and isn't already enrolled in RISE or Bridge. Now, within that category, needs more support. That can mean a lot of different things. Over my now 5 years as a LEAP teacher, I've kind of seen three types of students excel in LEAP. One are students who are like pretty solid in their skills, but like to have more time on their assignments, and or also benefit from like a one-on-one mentor tutor relationship in order to put all their potential into action. Second type of student are students who need a lot of support in building up their academic skills. And LEAP is one way that they can get that in a few different ways. Third type of student is our students who are just really busy after school. Maybe they play a sport every single season. Maybe they have family responsibilities. Whatever the case may be, maybe they have a long commute at the end of the day. And whatever the case may be, they don't have time in their life for their homework. And now all three of those types of students will also benefit from the LEAP curriculum. And then just remember that because LEAP's Area G elective credit, it's a college prep class, so you're staying on track. It's just a shell game about instead of taking the Spanish 1 in 9th grade, you might take it in 10th grade and still get your 3 years by 12th grade because the LEAP class that you took in 9th grade is freeing up space in your schedule later on.
Thanks. I don't know the question, like the questions about the deadlines. Is it December 15th registration deadline for those that wish to be transferred from a different district? I don't know any of the answers to the registration questions. Are those, do those go to our district office?
Yeah, so if you're enrolling into BUSD, the first deadline is December 15th. If you're trying to do an inter-district transfer, there's another process that you have to do, and you can find that on our website.
Okay, great. And the BHS, the admissions page, is that run by Francisco and the district office? Okay, so questions, all questions related to admissions, registrar, paperwork, et cetera, that is our registration office at the district. And so you should call there. You should call them to find out more information about the paperwork and why things are not updated, like the links aren't updated. That's on the district's end. Ninth grade AVID, I feel like I already answered, but that's an elective. And for the people that are wondering how to get information on electives, please go to the Berkeley High website, go to the course catalog. And the course catalog is from last year, but it's going to be pretty much the same, very similar. And in the middle of January, we should have a new course catalog for next year. Go ahead.
Somebody asked about zero period. There's also music classes offered during zero period.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Are all electives open to all ninth graders? Not every single one, but again, I would strongly recommend looking at the course catalog. That will be, it'll be pretty clear which ones are, it'll say in the descriptions if they are reserved for older students. Some of them are part of a progression. Again, the December 15th deadlines or registration deadlines are, that's something to take up with the district office. They're the ones who operate those. Dance is a PE option. It can count either as an art or as PE. In-person schools, in-person tours are through the front office, 510-644-6121. They can give you a an in-person, they can give you information about how to come in person. Let's see. LEAP compares with Avid. Avid is part of a program that advancement via individual determination. Again, I would look that up in the course catalog. They have a good description. It's a full class, so it's 30 kids versus LEAP, which is bought down to 12. Avid is not part of the Hives, and LEAP is. They don't really serve exactly related needs, but students would not take both. They would take one or the other. Advanced math placement, that's information that will come again from the district in January, February. So just pay attention to the website and that will be there. And I think we answered most of them. We talked about what LEAP is for. Okay, we did the enrollment packets. I think we're good. So dance classes done outside of school, that would be, you would have to get a PE waiver for that. It would not count as an art. We would never have an art waiver. It could count as PE, but again, you would have to check the requirements for the PE waiver to make sure that the dance classes qualify. And I don't know that they usually do. So this is something you would have to check on once you came to Berkeley High. And the bell schedule for now is the same, but keep an eye on news from Berkeley High because that could be changing. Again, language options, I'm just gonna take you to the course catalog, but they're basically Spanish, French, Mandarin, and Latin. Okay, I think we answered all of them. Yeah, I think that's everything. Does anybody see one we didn't answer?
The enrollment packet, it's in Spanish, and then at the bottom, it's also in English. So just scroll down and you'll be able to see it.
Yeah, non-BUSD folks, you should be checking the website. We don't have emails for non-BUSD people, and there's not one. We send emails out to our three local middle schools, and then all the other information would be through the through our website. Again, the list of electives, course catalog, Berkeley High School. If you just Google Berkeley High School course catalog, you'll find it. And then, yeah, if you do one fall sport and one winter sport, that does count as one full year of PE. Yes.
If you're non-BUSD and you want information, email Yolanda Brown Clark at berkeley.net and she can put you on an email list and keep you up to date with everything.
Yeah. Oh, that's actually really cool. Hang on, let me write that in. Selectives.
While you're doing that, Hosmik,
yeah, go ahead.
Are the genders for sports strict? Yes, students have to consistently identify as the gender for the sport that they wish to participate in. Some sports are already co-ed. There are a number of co-ed sports, including football, actually. But otherwise, if a student wants, students must participate in the sport. If it's a gender specific sport, they must participate in the sport that is consistent with the way they identify at school.
Awesome. Let's see. Reviews, standard practices or deadlines. I don't know what that means. again, the deadlines for current BUSD eighth graders will be, and we're gonna post this slideshow. So we'll definitely post this on the website. But you can also, where is that slide? The deadline for enrollment is December 15th, is that right? No. Let me check the slide. So if you are all continuing and new to BUSD students must register or rematriculate by December 15th. So to district's website, and you have to enroll even if you are a continuing student. Okay, I think, did we get everybody? Does anybody see any other questions we haven't gotten?
There was a question, what if a student doesn't identify as a boy or a girl? So the way that works is whichever sport you decide to participate in. So if you decide that you want to do girls basketball, then once you indicate that, then you will participate in girls sports. Is that correct, athletic director?
What was the specific question, Ms. Coleman? I'm sorry, I missed it. I think I already answered.
What if a student doesn't identify as a boy or a girl?
Right, they have to participate in one. What you said was correct, yes.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
No, PE waivers do not need, there's gonna be like once school starts, there's deadlines and then you just have to make sure to meet the deadlines, but nothing happens for the PE waivers before school starts.
And the in-person tour of the school happens at freshman orientation, or you can call the front office to schedule a tour for this year. Okay, sorry, go ahead, Ms. Coleman.
I was just saying, great job, team. Thank you so much.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, everybody. And thank you, families, as well. We look forward to seeing you guys next year. All right.